Hello and welcome to Queersay. I'm Andrew Kay and my guest once again is Ivor Kaplan.
Good to be here still, Andrew.
Good to have you here. And
We're both looking very smart today, aren't we?
Well, you're looking very smart and sober and very...
Very House of Commons-ish.
Very House of Commons-ish, which I think you're going
off to. That's where I'm off to next.
Yeah. Whereas I'm looking very bright and a bit more Coco the Clownish.
I wouldn't say
I'm
that.
I'm afraid.
I wouldn't say that about you, Andrew. You know
if you saw the size of my feet, you'd know exactly what I mean.
I'm not looking there either.
And that's another lie, isn't it? Let's move on. This is a story, and it's a British story. Thank heavens for British stories occasionally in the media.
I know.
Half of trans people have been a victim of hate crime in the last year.
Yes.
Now, this was a survey that's been conducted by Stonewall and YouGov, which surveyed 871 trans and non-binary people in the UK. 871 seems a pretty arbitrary number, but I guess they were aiming for 1,000 and ran out of steam.
Yeah, I mean, that's how YouGov do their polling, just to be on the sort of technical sophology side.
Right.
So that's fair enough. I mean, there are some shocking figures in here.
Well, it's this terrifying 41%.
Four in ten, 41% have been a victim of hate crime in the last 12 months. It's not good news. And I was taken by Stevie, who in some of the wider stuff that Stonewall have included in the research, says, I get shouted at every single time I leave my house and threatened at least once a week. I try to closet myself from my family because I'm so close to getting kicked out. This is terrible.
It's totally unacceptable.
Stevie is 21 and is basically hiding the gender identity from his family and getting abused by people. It's not acceptable.
It's no
not
way to live your life, is it?
It's no way for him to live his life. And it's no way, actually, for anyone to live their lives of any gender, of any type. And you know, this kind of behaviour has to be called out. And well done to Stonewall for actually calling it out.
Absolutely. I mean, it has to be said that, and I am in no way justifying here, but it has to be said that because the trans community has now got a stronger voice, there will be a stronger reaction to it, and that will change the statistics in a way.
It's not right. No,
but I think it's. I mean, in the same way that when we were fighting for homosexual equality all those years ago, when we did start to come out and actually walk down the street and say, "Well, you know, this is me. I'm queer. I'm here. Just learn to live with it."
Yeah.
We were getting the same sort of abuse then.
Yeah.
It's a transitional phase, I suppose. Doesn't make it right. I'm not justifying what is going on. But I am saying that it is actually swayed by that. The great thing is that what they need to learn from this, and what we all need to learn from this, is that you need strength at this time.
And what's interesting, Andrew, is that we've touched on this before, that kind of the new bit of LGBT rights is actually trans rights.
Yes.
Because for a lot of gay men, lesbians, we've actually been through what trans people are going through. It does seem to me that I hope Stonewall have got one of their great T-shirts. You know, some people are trans, get over it. I'd like to see some adverts on buses and tubes in London on that basis. But this transphobia is truly shocking. But it's on the other side of this, it's important it's reported. And we've touched on this before. Any hate crime, any LGBT hate crime, whether it's in the workplace or outside the workplace,
you need to report it.
Needs to be reported.
Once again, call the safety team.
We've got to call people out.
And call the police and let people know what's going on. Because if you don't make a story out of this, this isn't fake news, this is real news, and it needs to be dealt with. And you need to blow the whistle. We all need to stand up and be heard on these topics.
Yeah.
It's very important. Because the longer you do hide away, and I feel sorry for Stevie feeling that he has to hide away,
But just to finish the Stevie quote, I consider myself a warrior, but really something needs to change. And that is a very, very good line by Stevie. And well done to Stonewall for raising this. Mm-hmm. And we need to see more awareness of this. And of course, we're very proud to host Trans Pride every year. And I'd like to see that grow. And effectively what Trans Pride is, it's that kind of got the politics to do that we did 20, 30, 40 years ago.
And I'm going to apologise if I did actually misgender.
Yes, I think we both may have done in that piece.
I'm
but
not sure.
I apologise too.
But there we go.
That was the case.
There we go. Our next story is about a judge hitting out at a gay couple whose marriage has run into difficulties after having a surrogate daughter.
Mm.
It's not that much different from a conventional old school heterosexual marriage that comes into difficulties, is it?
No.
So why make such a deal out of it?
I felt like starting by saying this is complex family law, and it's not different for any couple in terms of that. For a surrogate baby, that surrogate baby by law in Britain, let's just talk about British law for the moment, something I know a bit more about.
Yes.
But for a surrogate baby, that baby has to be adopted. And that's how it works for gay couples. And of course, we're just over 10 years into adoption being approved. It's something in the latter part of the Blair government. But it is important that that families go through the right processes. And if you don't, then the only option for the court in Britain is that the mother has the rights.
Yes.
So, and that's when you get the breakdown, you get this complexity in family law. And also, just I know that people in surrogate relationships think there should be in Britain the sort of American thing where you can have agreements beforehand, etc., etc. But the various pieces of legislation relating to adoption and the Equality Act actually make it a criminal offence for solicitors to draw up a contract between the surrogate and the intended parents. So, there is some element for solicitors here where they have to be very cautious as well.
Do you think there are solicitors who are mistakenly doing this?
I don't think that would be the case. I think in England and Wales, and obviously very similar law in Scotland, it's very, very unlikely. Mm. The problem, I think, with this particular case is that it's a UK-US
yes.
complexity, and that just adds to the issues rather than finding this is being dealt with in the family court in London. So it is English law that will overrule yes. US law, which is probably helpful in any situation.
And the truth is that really this isn't about whether you're gay or not, because this is about adoption, this is about surrogacy, and this is about making sure that you know exactly what you're getting into.
This can and has happened before, where we've had US-UK cases on adoption stroke surrogacy. It will happen again. Mm-hmm. And the point for the point that the judge is making, I think absolutely correctly, is the judge says, it's a woman judge, under English law, the girl's surrogate mother would continue to be her legal parent. Mm-hmm. That is the law that we have in
UK.
This case, until that changes, and I don't see that changing, unless there is proper adoption. And that's what you need to do. And it applies, as you rightly say, Andrew, not just for gay couples, for everybody. Yeah.
Proper equality there.
Proper equality.
Mm. Let's move on. This is a horrible story, and this is from South Africa. This is a lesbian couple who were raped, killed, and then burned in a horrible attack. Unbelievable.
This is a terrible story. I mean, I've written here in my notes, horrible, horrible, horrible. Mm. It's in Pretoria, which is a bit more notorious in near Johannesburg for some of the actions that take place. I mean, I'm a big, big fan of Cape Town. I love it as a city. It's a very westernised city in Africa. I've even been to Pride there in 2014.
But this is taking place not very far away.
Well, Johannesburg is 3.5-hour flight between the two, Pretoria to Cape Town. It's not that far away.
No distance in modern terms.
But nevertheless, there is no excuse in South Africa for this, which is the most LGBT country in Africa by a long way. And I see that there's a lot of people have now going to be charged.
Well, there are eight people who've been charged and going to trial. One of them who has the amazing name, which is very appropriate at the moment, of Aaron Sithole. I did wonder whether that was a spelling mistake and Mr. Trump had been involved. It will be interesting to see exactly what justice is meted out to these guys.
Yeah, I mean, South Africa will take a dim view generally. Mm. As the ANC, as the ruling body, has done, and the the way that people have been dealt with has been very much, you know, quite harshly sometimes. But you can't allow this type of rape and murder to happen. And it's wrong for anyone. It's terribly shocking for us to find this happening to a lesbian couple who has been married for 3 years, because, of course, you can get married.
I think we can only really hope that
gay marriage exists in South Africa as well. So we do need to see justice, and something I'm sure we'll keep an eye on.
And we send our commiserations to the families of those two young women. Yeah. We're going to go to a break now, and when we come back, we're going to be talking about a GP weeping. That sounds like fun, doesn't it?
It does indeed.
Hello and welcome back to Queersay. I'm Andrew Kay, and my guest is Ivor Kaplan.
Well, I like this story.
This story
made me giggle.
I know. I'm not sure whether I should be laughing or not when I read this. But Dr. Farooq Patel was pictured outside Leicester Crown Court, where he was cleared of sexually assaulting a patient.
Yes, now, apparently he'd fondled, massaged his buttocks and
the Belgrave Medical Centre in Leicester.
Buttocks and groin after complaining of a bad back.
I didn't know there was a Belgrave Medical Centre in Leicester. I knew there was one in London.
I have no idea about
Leicester's
it.
Leicester's obviously going up in the world.
But this doctor is married, but he has previously had consensual homosexual encounters in a consultation room. Now, I get the sense here that this person who's made the claim has been made aware of this and has thought, maybe I can make a story here.
The complainant denied mentioning a groin problem to Dr. Patel, it says.
I know.
I mean,
when you go to the doctors, I mean, you are putting your life, your soul and your body on the table.
Especially if you've got a back problem.
Because you're going in and saying, there's something wrong with my body and I need you as a medical professional to help find out what that is.
Yeah.
So inevitably, I mean, I assume when I go to the doctors, if I'm complaining about something which is covered up by clothing normally, it might get touched uncovered.
Yeah. I mean, the interesting thing, just sort of from that sort of geeky point of view, is that it took the jury about just over 3.5 hours to come to the verdict. But the doctor himself didn't give any evidence in court, whereas you would have... obviously, he's innocent till proven guilty, so they'd obviously concluded that it would be better for him not to give evidence and to force the other party to try and prove the case.
Yeah.
And obviously, they couldn't do that.
Very, very, very strange story, this one.
Very strange. It was mildly amusing, though, because it is one of those sort of amusing legal stories that you can always like.
I think it's also, you know, we have a National Health Service which is under so much pressure, so much strain, that if, and I'm only saying if this person did go in and was being mischievous in any sense, either when he went into the surgery or when he's made this claim after his examination, then really, you know, grow up. For God's sake, you know, we're struggling to keep the nation healthy as it is, with restricted funding, a shortage of doctors, all of these things.
Yeah.
This sort of stupid behaviour, if that's what it was, is unacceptable.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's obvious that the patient had maybe a preconceived idea of what might happen. Maybe because he knew or whatever. We don't really know.
We don't know.
But he does claim he was, with the alleged indecent acts, that he was too terrified to stop it. Well, I'm afraid I'm not really buying that at all.
No.
And nor did the jury.
That's
the point.
And I think, you know, if you tell a doctor that you've got a problem with your groin, how are they supposed to work out what it is? I suppose they're supposed to get a couple of twigs out and divine a groin scrain. And it's stupid. Really silly.
Well, particularly if it's, for instance, sport-related, you can get groin strains and you would know what to do.
See, I wouldn't know that because I've never done sport in my life.
You go to the gym, Andrew, don't you?
I actually went to my doctor once and he said, my God, you must be the only homosexual in Brighton who doesn't have a gym membership. And I thought it was very rude of him because at that point I hadn't actually told him I was a homosexual. It was very observant.
It's a well-known fact.
I think most people have worked it out, yes. But no... I don't go to the gym. And the last sporting thing I did, I think, was probably in around 1968.
Oh, it was in black and white then.
When I used to swim for the school.
Oh,
and,
okay.
Long distance.
Well, swimming is good.
I know, I wish I still did it. And yeah. Then I wouldn't look like this, I would look like you.
But it's not swimming that does this. It's very nice of you to say so.
Not at all.
Thank you.
Not at all. Let's get away from this story. I really hope that there is a lesson to be learned out of this.
Yes.
Don't waste the time of our judicial system and our health service.
Indeed. If you've got a bad back, there are plenty of ways to solve it. You don't necessarily need the help of a GP. That's the story. Now,
our next story. I hate with all my heart reality television, and I particularly hate Big Brother, which to me is like having my soul sucked out through my nose very, very painfully. I just detest it, everything about it. But this time, once again, it's bringing up all these stories about homophobia.
Well, firstly, let me say personally, I don't watch Big Brother. So for the sake of reviewing these papers, obviously over the last few days, I've had to have a look at all that has been going on.
Do you feel your soul has been destroyed like mine?
I felt the need for a glass of wine to be able to do it, to be honest, which is where I think Celebrity Big Brother, or any version of Big Brother, would take me.
One of the things that mystifies me is the word celebrity.
I was about to say exactly the same.
I don't know who these people are. I mean, okay, I know John Barnes. Yes. I know the name. He's a footballer.
Yes.
That's about former as sporty footballer. As I get.
Former footballer.
Well, I wouldn't even know if he was still playing or not. I just know the name.
Well, no, but the funny thing is, in part of the clip that I saw, he actually says his reason for his comments is because he's 54. I've got no idea why age should demand that someone then makes homophobic comments. But he's done this with Courtney Act, who you will know.
Yes.
Courtney Act's a pretty well-known London drag star, by recollection.
I believe so.
Apparently, in the Big Brother house, Courtney Act has been having... is, by the way, also called Shane in Big Brother.
That's a quite sporty name,
not in drag, but has been having a bit of a thing with Andrew Brady. And this is what John Barnes then decided to intervene and say that basically, if anything went on between them, Andrew Brady would be out of the club. Now, I'm not quite sure what that means, but I'm making the obvious assertion that he would no longer be permitted to be friends with John Barnes and Shane. Now, that is the most ridiculous thing, because it just showed John Barnes to be, you know, somewhat idiotic, very homophobic, and wrong. Now, given he is a black football player, he will have been through that, and, you know, his playing days were 25 years ago, so...
He will have experienced bigotry
that we've discussed before in terms of these things. And it's really... It's totally unacceptable. I'm amazed that Big Brother haven't stepped on it. But I think Courtney Act stroke Shane actually dealt with it pretty well. I think he basically said, you are wrong, and laid out why. And Barnes's basic premise is that all gay men want to jump on it.
But isn't that a standard thing that you've been through all your life, where you've met people and they say, oh, you know, are you going to jump on me? And it's like... Do you know something? In my 61 years, I think I've had more sexual advances from heterosexual men than I have made to heterosexual men.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm no oil painting, but somehow there are men out there who live their lives as heterosexuals who seem to think that it's open season.
Yeah.
And it's not. Yeah. It really isn't.
And you know... Yeah, I mean, some of it is amusing, of course, because these kind of homophobic comments sometimes are amusing. So Courtney Act says, John had originally thought that masculine gay men could only be stereotypically butch with thick moustaches and leather jackets.
Ooh, well, yes, I remember the late 70s.
I was going to say, that is when you were playing football for Liverpool and England, and that is what was happening all those years ago. It doesn't happen now. And I was amused by the fact that Wayne Sleep stepped into this rap.
I love his final statement. This is wonderful. Wayne Sleep, who is and has always been openly gay.
He has. He
turns around and says, but that's so black and white.
Yeah, but he just says before that, Andrew, which is, I think is equally brilliant. For John, a gay man who doesn't have limp wrists is a straight man. And then he says, but this is so black and white. Question mark. Here you are, John.
Just for you. Little limp wrist. Our final story today, and we're only going to have a moment to talk about this, is can you turn gay after liking girls all your life?
Now, I'm going to start by saying, what is the Kinsey scale? Are viewers interested in the Kinsey scale? Is it something important to our lives across our city of Brighton and Hove? What on earth is it?
Well, it's so out of date. It's something that happened in the late 50s, it was a massive survey undertaken by an American university professor. Some of it was very interesting. Some of it seemed rather silly at the time. But I think this story is, can you turn gay after liking girls all your life? Maybe not. But you can fall in love.
Yes.
With someone because you fall in love with a person, not because you've fallen in love with either a man or a woman. Yeah. Someone who is trans, but because something in their spirit appeals to you and you love them.
Yeah.
And I think we all need to learn to retain the right to change our mind. And if that person is out there that I haven't met yet and they don't happen to be a man, well, that will be as wonderful as if I met a man.
It's all about love.
It's all about
That's
love.
The most important
what
thing.
What a wonderful way to end the programme.
Ridiculous things like this, Scott.
It is all about
all
love.
All about love.
Thank you for watching Queersay. See you again in a week's time. But for now, good night.